Wow, that's amazing. Holy cow. See you in a minute.
Dear friends and followers, lovely greetings from the Space Center Houston here in Houston, Texas. I am super excited to talk to you about the SCA, the shuttle carrier aircraft, the famous 747 with a space shuttle on her back. We'll be looking at the history of the 747, the space shuttle program, what structural changes had to be made to the plane in order to piggyback the orbiter, and further very interesting facts about this amazing combo. So let's saddle up and let's get started.
Liftoff, we have a liftoff, 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
After the Apollo space program came to an end in the early 70s, a new program was on the horizon. The STS, Space Transportation System, later known as the Space Shuttle Program, which was to take over the manned missions into space. Now, the primary difference to the Apollo program was that the Space Shuttle was a reusable spacecraft. Now, the Space Shuttle powered itself into low Earth orbit using a giant tank filled with liquid oxygen and nitrogen, a solid rocket on each side, and the three rear-mounted engines on the orbiter. And after 2 to 3 weeks in space, the orbiter would then descend into the Earth's atmosphere, flying without power, so effectively as a glider, soaring with 19,000 miles per hour towards the Earth, and landed on a very long paved runway. Now, early on in the testing phase of the program, engineers recognized that the orbiters might not be able to return to their launch site at Kennedy Space Center in Florida. For instance, if they had an engine malfunction after liftoff or due to unfavorable weather conditions. Now, this is a super interesting fact. Neither of the Space Shuttle orbiters could fly through the rain. The problem is, as it breaks through the Earth's atmosphere, it starts cooling off from more than 2,000 degrees, and its black thermal tiles shrink and leave gaps between them. Now, large enough that water will penetrate into them and rip off the tiles as they are only glued onto the fuselage. So in case it rained in Florida on the date and time of the shuttle landing or due to other reasons, the shuttle had to literally use alternate landing strips, and out of 135 missions to space and test flights, 57 of them did not land at Kennedy Space Center. So NASA somehow had to get their space shuttles back to Florida. But the big question was, how? Now, there were some ideas of attaching jet turbines to it so it could fly itself home, but the idea never became reality because of this man, John Kaika, an engineer at Johnson Space Center here in Houston, Texas. He came up with the piggyback idea of the space shuttle. Now, he had done the math if a 747 could potentially carry the space shuttle, and called up Boeing to pitch his idea. But not just that, he even proved Boeing that it could work by putting his idea on display with a model airplane replica. Boeing was convinced and designed a host link between the shuttle and one of their Boeing 747s. So the 747 you see here used to be the passenger plane for American Airlines and then purchased by NASA in 1970 to be converted into the shuttle carrier aircraft. And in order to do that, a few changes had to be made. So let's go inside and check her out. So this is what it looks on the inside of November 905 November Alpha, and by the looks of it, it doesn't look any much like a passenger aircraft anymore. After NASA purchased the plane, the first thing they had to do is shed some weight. So the entire interior got removed, seats, insulation and side panels, lavatories, absolutely everything. But in order to place a 70-ton heavy space shuttle on top of her roof, there had to be some structural reinforcements to be made along the lines of the attachment points. So as you see here, this beam and the one at the back were put into place to distribute the weight evenly through the walls of the plane, which were also strengthened and then into the frame of the aircraft. Externally, you have these three attachment points on the shuttle carrier aircraft, which connect to the shuttle, which are in the same location that the orbiters attach to the external tank for launch. At the aft section of the airplane, there are two struts which go up and inside the orbiter, and at the front there's a small little tripod adapter. And this picture here shows how cool the engineers were at the time. Attach orbiter here, note, black side down. This is absolutely hilarious. Also, a noticeable change is at the horizontal stabilizer. The engineers of Boeing and NASA were a little concerned that the hull of the shuttle would create an airflow shadow, so to make the vertical stabilizer less effective. Therefore, further vertical stabilizers were attached on the horizontal stabilizer, which later turned to be out wasn't that necessary actually, but you never know. Because after fitting the space shuttle with the aerodynamically shaped housing over the engines, the rudder was effective enough, but still, crosswind limits were drastically reduced due to the increased surface of the combo. The cockpit of the SCA, to be fair, is not much any different than other 747-100s. Okay, she got a few updates here and there over time, but the controls didn't need to be reinforced or similar. Now, the crew consisted of two NASA pilots, a captain and co-pilot, plus two flight engineers with the shuttle on top. So the empty weight of this 747, so without the shuttle and no fuel, she weighed around 144 tons. Plus a 70-ton space shuttle, plus 108 tons of fuel, she had a maximum takeoff weight of 322 tons, not more than a standard Boeing 747-100. Therefore, the landing gear didn't need to be reinforced. But flying-wise, there were some key differences. Now, the maximum cruising speed was only 250 knots due to the immense drag, which also dramatically reduced the plane's range from 5,500 to only 1,000 nautical miles. Also, because of the high drag and therefore the reduced power ratio, the plane couldn't climb as high as it could without the shuttle and was limited to 15,000 feet. Also, when she wasn't mated with the space shuttle, they had to place extra ballast into the plane as the center of gravity was otherwise outside of its limits. So whenever a shuttle re-entered the Earth's atmosphere, the pilots were literally hoping for bad weather in Florida so that the shuttle had to divert and glide to one of its alternate landing strips, such as the Edwards Air Force Base in California. Now, the pilots would then fly to California and wait for the MDD to do its job first. The mate-demate device, which is a massive steel structure with which the space shuttle could be lifted up and be prepared for its taxi flight. Now, then the 747 was pulled under the MDD, and within 24 hours, the shuttle was placed into its connector points, and later that day, this amazing-looking combo would then fly back to Kennedy Space Center, where the shuttle again demated from the 747 to get fitted with its new tiles, new engines, etc., to be ready for its next launch into space. But besides being the taxi service for the space shuttle, the 747 also played a crucial part in the development of the space shuttle itself. The most important test these two did together was the ALT, the approach and landing test. The first shuttle, Enterprise, was placed on top of the 747 and flown to 27,000 feet, where it was then released, or so to say, air launched during a special maneuver. The aerodynamic tests and data gained from these flights played a crucial part in providing the shuttle's ability to glide down to the landing strip and helped engineers refine the shuttle design and future simulators. To be fair, I could ramble on for hours just about the space shuttle itself. Here's something you can do. If this video gets more than 100,000 likes, I will make sure to record a video in the space shuttle cockpit at the Kennedy Space Center and explain it to you what it's all about. But sadly, in 2011, the shuttle program came to an end. Well, let's better say it was completed. And this 747, which is actually one out of two carriers NASA had in service, delivered Endeavour in 2012 to its resting place at the Science Center in South Los Angeles. And in 2013, a decision was made to preserve this beautiful plane and display it at the Space Center Houston with the mock-up shuttle Independence mounted on its back. She was then flown to Ellington Field, where she was carefully dismantled, ferried to Johnson Space Center in seven major pieces, reassembled, and finally mated with the replica shuttle in August 2014. At the end of their active service, both shuttle carrier aircrafts, the older November 905 November Alpha and the younger November 911 November Alpha, went on a tour through America delivering the space shuttles to their respective museums. The attention these two aircrafts received were out of this world. Thousands of people gathered at airports to see this unique combination take off and land. Personally, it makes me cringe a little that this whole idea with mating the two aircraft together and even air launching it off the back of the 747 was all based on the idea of John Kiker and his model airplanes. People back then were incredibly proud and honored to be either working on this project or just being fascinated by the two of them flying by. In 30 years of flying, 227 flights, the majestic image of the spacecraft joined to the 747 became a symbol of American invention and ingenuity. I'm sad that my layover here in Houston is only one day. I could easily spend an entire week here at the Space Center Houston. If you are in the city, do yourself a favor and visit this incredible place. Here you will discover the real thing, including flown spacecrafts, a moon rock you can touch, and a behind-the-scenes tour of the real facilities at Johnson Space Center. In order to get tickets, click onto the link in the description box below and check out the website of the Space Center Houston. That's it for today. Thank you very much for your time. Click onto that like button so I can go to the Kennedy Space Center and record from the Space Shuttle cockpit. Whew, that's exciting. Here's your checklist for today. Subscribe to my channel, check, activate the notification bell, check, follow my Instagram account, check, and don't forget, a good pilot is always learning. Wishing you all the best from Houston, Texas, your Captain John.